You're on the record as saying that climate scientists should fly less or not at all because of the example they set, and how it blows their personal carbon budget. By the same logic, should not all climate scientists be vegetarians or even vegans?
Well, ultimately, actually, although I've said this about the flying, what I'm trying to get across there is that we, as climate scientists who are engaged in the subject and think it's very serious, then I think that we have to live within what we think is a reasonable carbon budget. Now, always we have to move in towards that as quickly as we reasonably can. You then have a set of choices within that budget. I think this is one thing we have to be very careful about, those of us who are trying to push for change, is not to try to pick what it is that people must do, but from a climate perspective, you might make broader arguments from a sustainability or animal welfare perspective, but from a climate perspective, what we're saying is staying within what we consider to be appropriate budgets. And within that, if you want to own a Lamborghini and drive it for 30 miles a year and live in a cold house and do no flying the rest of the year, then, hey, you can blow your carbon budget by doing that. Alternatively, if you want to live in a slightly warmer house, then you may have to have a smaller car or no car at all and use a lot more public transport. So I think we have to be quite careful in saying it has to be one thing or another. The thing about flying is that any reasonably long flight pretty much is starting to blow our carbon budget, because it is so profligate in terms of emissions compared with other activities that you could do in any similar period of time. So, you know, if I decide I want to spend an hour travelling somewhere, in an hour I can probably get to, I'm not sure how far I can get, but I can probably get to southern France in an hour on a plane, or to, you know, somewhere well in the Mediterranean. As with an hour locally from where I live, I can get myself in the Peak District and I can go climbing for the day. The difference between the two in terms of emissions is enormous. So therefore, as soon as we decide to step on a plane, then we are, you know, for that period on the plane, we are pumping out enormous quantities of carbon dioxide that will blow our budgets. And hence, aviation is the exception from the other options that we have, whereby we have some flexibility in choosing what we want to do with our limited carbon budget. So I do think that whether you have to become a vegan or a vegetarian, and actually, of course, the jury's out, the science on that is actually quite, it makes the energy side of the climate change agenda look quite straightforward. Understanding emissions from agriculture, from a whole set of other gases, from how you even compare the gases, is actually very difficult indeed. And as soon as you start to work with biology, the emissions are nowhere near as certain as they are when you burn a litre of fuel. You know exactly what you're going to get from that particular litre of fuel. You don't know from week to week what the emissions are going to be from animals or from any flora and fauna. So I think there's a lot of scientific uncertainty there. Certainly, the science seems to be suggesting quite strongly that the red meats, the ones that actually aren't necessarily particularly good for our health, if we eat a lot of them anyway, that they tend to be ones that are that go along with relatively high carbon dioxide or greenhouse gas emissions, call it that. So there seems certainly to be some clear messages that we can steer away from certain types of animal, certain types of meat, certain types of foods. But like most things, it's probably, again, if you had that as a celebration, if the return of the prodigal son or prodigal daughter, you kill the fatted calf, and that's once a year, it's probably not such a problem from an emissions point of view. We just normalise that way of living now, that we think it appropriate to eat meat in all sorts of forms day after day, and I think that's what we probably have to question from an emissions point of view.
Still on flying and offsetting, you famously a couple of years ago declined to attend a conference because the organisers had put offsetting in as part of their carbon budgeting. I did see that you attended a conference recently. There were 15 speakers, 14 of them were men, and all of them were white. And I'm wondering, would you consider having a gender and race balance on panels as one of your preconditions for attending conferences?
Well, probably not a precondition, but it's something I'll try and take account of. And indeed, when we ran our own conference last December, we made quite an effort to try to get as good a balance as you could get. Ultimately, of course, you're constrained by who applies to come to the conferences, who will put their abstracts in. But then there is still a responsibility on us to recognise that society is such that it already marginalises particular groups, from a gender point of view or from a cultural point of view or from a race point of view. And therefore, if we recognise that in advance, that it's appropriate for us to go out and try and push harder to get the people from those other communities to engage. But at some point, of course, if you're trying to organise a conference and you've got your day job as well, you can only push so hard. And we pushed, in our own conference, we tried very hard on that, and it was very time-consuming to do that. Nevertheless, I do think it's important for all of us to recognise that if what you have is a lot of wealthy white males telling 7 billion people around the planet of all sorts of colours, hues, cultures, backgrounds, that we must make these sorts of changes, clearly that message is going to be much less open and accessible to a lot of the community than if you had a panel that was much more representative in many respects, and that also, of course, had a better understanding of the different cultural problems and environments within which we have to bring about these levels of changes. I wouldn't make it a precondition. I would certainly mention it to. I have mentioned it when I've been to events when I said we're all men on the panel, which happens quite a lot. Though more often now we are getting some women on the panel, and then you find but we're all white on the panel. So that's another big issue. And the other part about that, actually, we try to address gender. We make some attempt at trying to address issues of race and culture. What we don't do, by and large, at the moment, is address anything to do with, I don't know what the appropriate term, you could call it class, you could call it income. So what we generally get are wealthy people that are on panels. Now, regardless of their gender or their race, they're generally going to be wealthy. And which means they're usually in the high emission categories anyway. But then we're talking to other people who are not in our position. And I think getting an understanding of other people who have to deal with the sorts of policies that us wealthy people are trying to effectively put in place and impose on others, to get the other's view of what those things look like from that side, I think would be really important. And we have, we're not just on climate change, across the board, we fundamentally fail on that. We try on gender, we try on race, and we simply fail every single time on getting a better balance in terms of people in different, I don't like the term, sort of tiers or socioeconomic groups, but effectively, that's what we mean by it. So people who have to deal with these things from a very different stance, a very different wherewithal to deal with what we put in place.